RDFS vocabulary has these shapes, applications, and tools. That it's the title of the tutorial, and here is probably is the interesting thing is that we have like 20 minutes to review this list of applications and tools, and for me the interesting thing is that in the last 3 years this is what has changed in the last 3 years. I did this tutorial, the first version of validating RDF tutorial for the Semantic Web Conference, I think it was in 2017 or 18. It was 2 years ago, and a lot of things have changed because a lot of applications and tools have appeared, a lot of use cases, a lot of people are using them, and so that's quite successful. So I divided the presentation in two parts. One part is about applications, just application and use cases. Another part is about tools, tools and challenges. Again, this is my personal point of view of the different tools and applications and things that you can do with the shapes. Okay, first of all, data portals. I was thinking about removing these three slides, but at the end I kept these slides because this was the first application where I used shape expressions. In fact, I used shape expressions even before I had an implementation for shape expressions. So that was quite interesting. The thing is that at that point in time, it was in 2013, at my research group at WESO, West Semantics Oviedo, we were hired to develop several data portals. One of the data portals was the Web Index. And the Web Index was a data portal, and nowadays, I said that I was planning to remove it because it is no longer maintained. So it was 7 years ago. But it was a nice application where you have different data, statistical data, and you could we represented the data using the RDF data cube vocabulary. So you have all of the data were observations. We defined a data model, and that data model was defined using shape expressions. So this is a simplified view of the data model. The central point here are observations, and these observations have observation belong to a data set. It has a slice, and this slice have an observation. So you notice that one important thing is that you can see that this is a cyclic data model, so you have recursion. And this is why when there was this discussion between Sex and Shackle in the working group, for me, not being able to define this kind of data models with recursion in a simple way was something that I thought that was mandatory, because most of the use cases for me were going to have this kind of cyclic data models. At the end, a data model, imagine if you are not allowed in a data model to have these dependencies where you say that you have a person that works for a company, and the company has a property which is employee that points to the person. That's for me, it doesn't make any sense. So from that first usage of sex for a data model, I obtained several lessons. One lesson was that it was very nice sex to document the data model. In fact, I have this link. This is the documentation of that data portal, and it has a very nice thing is that at that point I was like the architect, the information architect of my team, and I had several developers, and I asked the developers to implement that data, and I wanted to put a list of the different properties that I wanted and all that. And it was very practical to have a way to do it in a language that was machine processable. So it was very important to communicate between our teams, and also you could also have a tool to validate, but I have to say that we didn't use that tool at that point in time because we didn't have implementations for that. But at the end we have a way to check if our nodes conformed to SunSafe. But at the end, what was also very interesting from the perspective of time is that we were able to reuse several of that data model of those shapes in another project. We were hired to develop another project which was called the Land Portal. And in the Land Portal, the data were again observations, but again, those observations had the same time of RDF data cube observation, but had a different structure. And this is something that this is what I was talking later. Maybe you have this one ontology, which is RDF data cube, or one vocabulary is the observations. You have observations in RDF data cube, but then you can have two projects. One of the projects is the web index, another project is the LAMP portal, and those two projects are using nodes of type observation, but have different data models that have different views of the properties or different constraints of the properties that they are going to use from that ontology. So this is a practical example of what we were talking before. So this was the first example, that the first use case for shape expressions, and there is, I mean, I kept this slide because for me it was, I was one of the motivations for using sex. Another very popular use case of shape expressions nowadays is Wikidata. Wikidata are using shape expressions they started last year in 2019. You have, and this is a link for an entity schema. I mean, let's go to some example. Oops. So this is, let's go to, okay, so if we go to the entity schema in Wikidata, so this is let's go to E42, which is simpler. So E42 is the schema of author in Wikidata, and it has these properties, and it can be used to validate. If you, I wanted to try it here, let's see if it works. For example, we can check entities. If you go to Wikidata, I can put this in the Slack channel. So if you want to check if entities validate, you can click check entities to validate. Now the tool is not using, is using this sex online validator. Then you can, okay, let's do it in a different tab, because I want to use here, let's ask for several authors. So if you want to validate, you can put here a Sparkle query. So we are asking for values of type person. We can query the values, and then we have here the entities to validate, and we check validate, and it will start validating. Okay, so it's validating. Using shape expressions is validating items from Wikidata. So this is one way to do it. And the other way, there is you can do it also with RDF shape, but also we created another tool which is called wikishape.weso.es. I will put also the link here. This is a project which is very similar to RDF shape, to the previous RDF shape, but this is focused, is the same, the code behind, the underlying code is the same, but this is focused for people in Wikidata, because some people in Wikidata, maybe they are not aware of some of the RDF things, so for example, the namespace declarations and all that. But for example, here you can go to schemas, you can obtain information about a schema. For example, you say author, you have auto completion, you obtain information about the schema. And I also wanted to show it because in the case of shape applications of tools, one of the applications that I will talk later is about editors of shape expressions. And here we have this editor that has autocomplete notice and also can have this, for example, if you go here, you can see that it says Q5 is human, P31 is instance of. So it has these suggestions. And also, for example, if you write, for example, prefix WDT, notice that it also has autocomplete when you are writing. So this editor is also, I think it's interesting and also very useful for people from Wikidata, because people from Wikidata, they not everybody is expert in semantic technologies, on Spark and all that, and they find these tools very useful. Okay, so this is this editor. This is one of the editors that I will talk later about this editor. So as you can see here, you have this schema, and also you can validate here. For example, let's check if it works. Let's say, for example, a typical example is Douglas Adams is as an author, and we ask to validate, and let's see if it validates. Okay, maybe it's if it takes. It takes a little bit of time because Douglas Adams has a lot of arcs, but I think. Okay, and now it's validated. And here it says it's validated, and you have here some information, some details of why it validated. Okay, so this is a tool that I think is useful to the people who are working with Wikidata. So you can validate, you can here we don't have yet a tool to create entity schemas from here, but it's something that we still need more time to work on that. This is a tool Wikisite that I think is useful for people who are interested on Wikidata and validating Wikidata. Okay. Okay, so this is one of the things. And the other use case that I found very interesting is also especially because of this blog post being from Ruben Berbor, where he said that I just can't stop thinking about saves. It was like a joke, but he was saying that in the Solid project from, this project from Tim Berners-Lee that is promoted by Tim Berners-Lee, they are planning to use saves to validate the data that are from pods. And that's also very interesting. I think there are working on implementations on or using saves for that. I also think this is very interesting. So it's a very nice use case. And there are other use cases. There are a lot of other use cases. In Fire, they also were using saves. There also the AELI validator that is using saves. And this example is also very interesting because they are taking these saves from spreadsheets. So that's something that I'm planning to talk later. Also, they also have SACL. The adoption by Top Quadrant. I was talking with people from Top Quadrant that they tell me that there are a lot of companies that they are using SACL for the internally to the and saves to validate their data. But the names of those companies is not something that we can do public. But there are, and I am also aware of several companies, several big companies that are using saves. So now let's go to the next topic: is this challenges and perspectives about Solid. So I divided this topic in four parts: about validating with saves, obtaining saves, other applications of saves, not only for validating, and save ecosystems. About validating saves, there are different ways to validate: libraries, command line validators, online demos, and let's review them. This is a very personal point of view because these are the libraries that we are developing at my research group in Hueso. We have, and notice that we have the SACLEX is a library that is importing two libraries. One in all of them are implemented in Scala. One is sex validating shape expressions. The other is circle. But here I have a common definition of a schema that I can work with both, and I also can convert between sex to circle. That's also something that people, when some people ask me, should I use sex or should I use circle? It's very difficult, especially for people who are coming from companies. Some people who come from a company, they are forced to use a W3C recommendation. If that's your case, probably you should use Shackle. If you are not so forced to use that, and you prefer a language which I think has some nice things, for example, you could use sex. If you don't use very advanced features, you could later convert between sex to shackle. Okay, so at the end, it's not death or life decision that you have to take. And also I am using SRDF. It's a library that allows you to work with, also with Jina or RDF4J. Also, the online demos, if you want to play, I already saw RDF Shape and Wiki Shape are two online demos. They are divided. I did that last year. So they are divided in a client part, which is implemented in React, in JavaScript in React, and a server part, which is implemented in Scala. Okay, so if you want to improve this client part and you are a JavaScript and React expert, please contact us and contribute, because all of these libraries in Hueso are open source and they have a MIT license and you can play with that. But also there is the possibility to integrate shapes with other tools. For example, the Top Blade Composer is a commercial tool to work with ontologies and RDF data and all that, and it has Shackle support. But also, for example, Protege, there is a plugin for Protege for Shackle. This was not done by our group, but we are working in a plugin for Protege for shape expressions. That's something that is being done in our research group. And also, again, it works, but we have several problems with the integration between Java and Scala that we are trying to solve. Okay. Want to contribute? Please do it. Some work that we are currently doing is to have a validation of shapes that are combined with ontologies. So this is the idea that you have the ontology engineer is working with ontologies in a Git repository, but you also have some test data and you define some shapes that check that the data conforms to the ontology, but also before and after inference. And also you can have shapes that check the conformance before inference and shapes that check the conformance after inference. So you can't even check the behavior of the validator, of the inference system. That's something that we found it interesting and useful, and we are working on that technology. One project that is working on that is the Yen Ontology project. They have this Go Shapes repository. They are defining shapes for that, and we are working on this Ontolo-C, which is a system that integrates on shapes, ontologies, test data, and provides a nice, if you know about Travis, this is like Travis, but to validate RDF data with shapes and ontologies. Okay, we have this repository there. About text editors, this is the JASE, this is the editor I was showing before, and about how to create shapes. You can have test-based editors. This is this slide should be after this one. And also you have these visual editors and visualizers. The shapes authors, the visual editors, one of them is a Top Blade Composer. There is this Unshackled editor, and this is Sex Author. I have one slide for each of them. This is the Top Blade Composer. This is the Unshackled, but unfortunately I tried to use it and I was not able. I'm not sure how it works yet, but this is a script capture. And we have also this Sex Author it has been done by one of my students, by Pablo Menendez. The idea here is to have something similar to the Wikidata query service, where you have on one screen, you have the shape expression, but on the other hand, on the other part of the screen, you have the visual representation of the shape expression. So this is the idea. So you have a visual representation, and you can synchronize between both representations. And you can. Some people prefer to work as a text editor. Other people prefer to work in a visual way, and you can change between them. So this is something that we are working. We are also working on visualization of shape expressions. We have these two projects, UML Sacless. They are both integrated in RDF Shape. So if you want to play in RDF Shape, you can play with them. But they are a bit different. This is the first one that I was implementing. And this new one works through the conversion to XMI. So the idea is that then you can use those XMI files to, for example, put them in a UML tool like Visual Paradigm or Enterprise Architect, similar. Then another topic, another way to create shapes is to create shapes from spreadsheets. That's something that I also, in practice, a lot of people. I mean, when I was before talking about data engineers, is because I think there is a profile of people who are not ontologists. They don't like so much to think in terms of ontology, but they are very practical people who want to define the data model of the graphs, of the RDF graphs that they are working with. That people also, they are not very technical, but they know that data model. And if they know that data model, they usually prefer to work with spreadsheets. We found that a lot of times in practice, and that's why we are, I mean, there are several projects in this category. So there's these people from, they defined the ELLI, was defined with spreadsheets, but there is also this sex statements project that obtains from spreadsheets, generates shape expressions, and there's a project from Dublin Core that they're also working on CSV representation of shapes, and we are also working on this. This project Hermes is that we process CSV files and we generate shapes. The other way is to extract, automatically extract from RDF data. If you know the, if you already have data, you want to generate the shape of that data. So another way is to, so this project is called, there are several projects. One of them is Sexer. I think I have a slide for each of them. And I have to say that probably the end time was going to be one, but probably if you allow me, I will take like 10 minutes more, and I mean, I have no problem to take 10 or 15 minutes more if you have. Okay, so let's go to for example, this is a way to generate, this is a shape that was automatically generated from instance data. For example, if you go to this entity in sex, then you, from this entity, you can generate the shape expression that it has. And also Sexer can do the same thing. And also this shape designer is another tool. Shape designer is another tool that also allows you to extract or to create shapes from existing data. This is the same. Okay, and also I found looking at the proceedings of the Semantic Web Conference, I found this paper called that there is a tool called Astrea that generates shackle shapes, in this case not from RDF data but from ontologies. So I recommend you to attend this session. I think, I don't know if anyone, I think it was next Wednesday, but I'm not sure. But if you're interested, you can look at the program. So they are going to present this tool. Continuing, following with other uses of shapes, not only for validating, I found these three usages of shapes. One is to create user interfaces. So if you want to have a user interface taken from shapes, so let's go here. It was something that even in the working group, from the beginning of the working group, that was a use case that was already seen interesting, how to define user interface from shapes. But the recommendation, the shackling recommendation, it has several properties. For example, it has the property order, which it's like a hint to say that one constraint is before another constraint, or group, to group several constraints, but it doesn't go farther than that. Sex also has annotations, but also it didn't go farther than that than having annotations. So you have several annotations. But for example, in sex, Eric Prudemou is working in this kind of tool, which is, I think, is quite nice. Oops. Let's go. So this kind of tool I wanted to show you is a tool. Where you can have, for example, I mean, you have this. This is the sex. This is the shape expression. And this, he is using examples from Solid, from the Solid project. You have a user profile, has a telephone, an address, etc. Then you define the layout, and in the layout, you say, okay, the user profile should be called user profile. Let's change this. I'm going to execute then and change this so you can see that it works. And then you can generate the form. So the form is, if you click here, you obtain, this is the form. As I said, you can play here. You can say user profile at ISWCC, and you can see that this is updated. So as you can see, the form is generated between this combination between shape expressions and layout descriptions. Here, it is using a language which that we are working on. This language is called SexPath. I already have a partial implementation, and he has a partial implementation of this language that allows you to point to parts of a shape expressions to indicate those parts of the shape expressions how you want to visualize them. Okay, so this is something that we are working in shape expressions. In the case of Shackle, also there is another proposal which is called they call it there's like a special vocabulary to define forms, and this is an example of a form taken from that document. But also I found that there is another presentation, I think in this Semantic Web Conference, about another tool called Schematos that also allows you to generate nice visual interfaces for Shackle. I tried it, I was able to use it, and this is a screen capture, but I didn't have much more time than that. Okay, so you can attend the presentation. Okay, continuing with other things that you can do with shapes, or things that we are currently using shapes, is to generate Java code from shapes. I mean, this is something that we are going to present it. There is another demo in the Semantic Web Conference, and one of the authors is Guillermo Facundo. He is going to present a tool. We called it SexLite, but it should be the SexLite processor. It takes a subset of shape expressions and generates Java code. So, and you could say, okay, but why? The idea is that this is in a project we have here in Spain. We have a shapes library. This shapes library usually comes from a set of UML diagrams or even spreadsheets, where you have a spreadsheet is like where you define the data model. And we want to have this shapes library synchronized with the Java code that is going to be used by the semantic architecture. So here we have a set of, so this is a part of the implementation that is been developed by, in fact, this is been developed by a different people from another company. And here, the people in the research group in Hueso, we are working here in the shapes library, and we are generating Java code, but we are only generating pollos, plain old Java objects. We generate plain old Java objects, we define the data model, and using a clean architecture pattern, the developers here are working with those Java objects that we generate from the saves library. Okay, there is another possibilities to use saves to do some kind of inference. So you combine saves with rules, and this is an example. Imagine that you have this save is saying that a rule is that if you have the width is the same as the height, then and you check that you have the height, it must be an integer, the width also must be an integer, and if you check that they are the same, then you have this rule. So these are some kind of premises, and this is the conclusion, but you generate a rule where you are going to say, okay, let's generate a subject with this value that has the predicate RDF type and the object square. Which this means that for every rectangle, you are going to infer which of them are squares. So for example, here, if you have this one is a rectangle, but this is invalid, so it's not going to generate anything. This one is not a rectangle, so it has the height and width is different, but this one has the same height and the same width, so you infer that S is a square. So you can use shapes to infer new things. And this is related with the question, and the first question from Francisco about the place of Shackle with regards to ontologies and rules. This is a usage of shapes that I am not very fond. I think it's interesting. You can do that, but you are entering a new territory of rules from a language which was defined to describe shapes. So I would prefer not to enter there, but the people who are supporting Shackle and the top rate, they entered there and they are quite happy and they have several reports on that. So that's how it is working. I really don't know how it's going to evolve. I really think that there is a need for rules on top. I mean, but I'm very happy when there are more than one way to solve the same thing. So we have data, we have ontologies, we have shapes, and people also have rules. If you put those rules in the ontology, or if you put those rules in the shapes, that's something, or in a different place, that's something that I don't have a solution for. Okay, so I don't know if you want to say something about that, Francisco. Maybe
the only thing I wanted just to, it's just basically, again, we are talking about two different things. So if you are going into rules, basically you are going into closed wall assumptions, you go into unique name assumptions, and all these kind of things that are different to what, for instance, OWL is the basic foundation, right? So I don't say that this is wrong one possibility or the other. I think that there are people, particularly coming from databases, they feel more comfortable with this sort of things, with rules, with the constraints and all this kind of thing, because they don't understand this concept of open world semantics. That is something that is just too weird for them. But as I said before, also in the semantics web, in the World Wide Web, it makes sense if you assume the fact that basically you might not have all the information available. So that is.
Yeah, exactly. So this, I mean, it's something is debatable, and I also think that it will depend a lot on the domain. So I don't have a solution for that. Probably it's something that is going to be evolving. But I think that there is a space for all of them, for ontologies, for shapes, and for rules. But combining, as I said, the thing. My point is. Here, this proposal that comes from Shackle and combining Shackle rules is like trying to combine several concerns that probably I would, I mean, I am very happy with separation of concerns. So I think probably those concerns, rules, should be different from shapes. But okay, that's my, so this is something that is debatable. Okay, let's continue. So there is another work that we are doing in my research group. It is this is a work that is being done by Erminio, one of my PhD students, is to use shapes for data integration. This is part of his PhD. He started at what I could call the high level. So he started, and we have a paper in the Semantic Web Journal where we convert from a schema to a schema. So imagine you have data that has an XML schema, and you convert from XML schema to shape expressions. So this is the first thing that was done, but we have a paper about that. But later, at the low level, you also have data. And that data, not you don't always have a XML schema. Sometimes yes, but you don't need to have that. So later he started to work on a language to convert between this data in an easy way to RDF. So he defined this domain-specific language called SexML. This is inspired by RRML, but he was using inspiration also from Sex in the syntax of the language. So you have, I mean, if you go to the link, you will see an example there. And the idea is that with this language, you can easily map different data from XML, etc., to RDF, and the idea also is that later you could even check if they conform. Now, even with this language, with XML, he also has the possibility to generate shape expressions, so you later could check if they conform. So this is working. I mean, we have a recent paper that has been accepted, but hasn't yet published, but soon it will soon be. Published, and if you are interested, send me an email and we can send you a preprint. Okay, and finally the last thing that I like, I am very happy with that. I mean it's something that I really am very interested in, how it's things are evolving when people have a space to define their shape expressions, and if they have a collaborative space, they start creating different shape expressions for different purposes, and that's what is happening in the Wikidata. In Wikidata, as I said, you have the possibility to have shape expressions for different kinds of entities, but the thing is that if you go, someone in Wikidata created this this directory of entity schemas. So you can see a list of the entity schemas that have been developed for Wikidata. And you have, for example, for arts, for biology. There are a lot of them for biology because, some people who are working, for example, in biology, there was a bio hackathon, and I was participating in that bio hackathon. So we defined several shape expressions here for strains and different things. There are also for chemistry, for etc. And you can see that there are some of them, for example, these shape expressions, they are importing others. For example, I am not an expert here, so for example, you have a chemical compound, so this entity schema imports lipids, and also natural products, and stereoisomer. So you can see that there is a relation between schemas, and they are evolving, and also in a natural way, in a collaborative way, in the way that Wikidata works with this. And this is something that is evolving, and going back to my slides, what I like here is a lot of research questions can appear. For example, how do you relate the different schemas? How are how is the evolution of the different schemas? How do you search the entity schemas? All these questions are interesting. And when you have this kind of libraries of shapes, and this what I have shown is a library of shapes in the same domain for Wikidata, but you could also have a library, a shape library in another place for other data, and you could also import shapes from those libraries and combine those shapes. So this opens a new set of questions that I don't have any answer yet, but we are working on that. And if someone wants to work on that, let me know. I know that there is work on this from the database world, from database schemas. So I mean, this is not that we are inventing a new wheel, but we have a new wheel already. Maybe we should look at what are the people that have different wheels, how they used those wheels, and probably we need to take inspiration from that for this for safe expressions and also for Shackle. Okay, so and that's the end. And I want to show this picture, this nice picture here. So as conclusions of the tutorial, but now I will open for if you have some questions, let me know. I think Sex and Shackle in the last 3 years have had a very great level of adoption. I didn't expect so much adoption. I started this almost by chance because I had practical problems and I wanted to solve them. Also, I think that there are a lot of tools that are appearing both in Shax and both in Shackle. Sometimes they are the same tools, but one for Shax and the other for Shackle, which is kind of interesting. I think there are a lot of new challenges and around shapes ecosystems, and also I have some hope that in the future these new results between negation and recursion could help some kind of conciliation between Shax and Shackle. So, as I said, some people consider me like a Shax guy who only wants to promote Shax instead of Shackle, and it's not the truth. I don't know if in the audience there is someone who thinks about that. He wants to say something, because what I really want is to both Shax and Shackle to be adopted and to learn from those adoption, and also to increase the quality of both. I mean, at the end is not of both, but the data, the quality of the data. Okay, so some questions, Thomas. Using shapes to navigate complex information, like when it's hidden information object with secondary. I have to say that not really. I don't have examples from that. And I mean, there is an example that goes in that direction. But that's I think I even removed from the slides, because I have other slides that are in the backup, but it's not here. I removed them, which is we had implemented in Weso a tool called Wesby. Wesby was inspired by Pubby. It's called Wesby. I will put the name here. But the project is discontinued. It was a final master thesis of one of my students, and he started to work, and he didn't continue with that. In that project, one of the goals we had was to be able. We'll put the Slack channel here. So in this project, Wesby, one of the projects was to have a linked data browser inspired, we wanted to have a linked data browser where you have the different triples, but in that linked data browser, we wanted to show the information different depending on the shape of the node. Which means if you have a node that is a person, and if you know that node has a name and age, knows several people, then the visualization of that node could be different than if you have a node that, for example, has a shape of a city. You have a node that is a city, then you can put in the visualization the geographical coordinates, and you can put a link to Google Maps or whatever. So I think that example goes in that direction, that when you have complex information and you have a shape expression that defines the shape of that complex information, you can have a visualization that adapts to that complex information. But that project, as I said, we didn't continue with it. I was planning to work on that, and that's the most similar thing that I can find for that. And if you know about someone, please let me know. So I would be happy to. I have to say, yes, in the slide, I have this last slide about acknowledgements is in the book, I had created this GitHub repository where I contained a list of implementations for shape expressions and Shackle. Vladimir Alexeev started a wiki in this repo where people could put their implementations. And I saw a lot of people put there the implementations, and it really helped me to prepare these slides, because when I was preparing the slides, I went to that web page and I found a lot of tools that I was not aware of that. So Thomas, if you know about something, just let me know, because I am interested on that. Okay. Okay, any more questions? I don't know if you still have the chance to open your micro or not, but if you have, you want to talk, please do it. No more questions? Okay, but in that case, I really thank you for attending the tutorial. I hope that it was useful. I also hope, if you have curiosity about shape expressions or Shackle, that you try to use any of them or to work on this. And if you have any question, just let me know, and I would be very happy to do any collaboration or whatever.